Good morning, everybody. How are you guys all doing? I hope you guys are doing well. I hope you guys have had your coffee, tea, whatever it is that you guys need to get rocking in the morning. Okay, Tool fans, I guess I have made you wait long enough. We are on our final song on our Marie, Mary, what, I'm so confused. I think it's Marie Journey. This is Wings for Marie Part 2. Let's get it. Oh, just let you guys know, I looked high and low for a lyric video for this. I only found one, and the one that I found was actually taken down by the label. So they don't want a lyric video, guys. I don't know what to tell you. So I'm sorry. Let's get it. Okay, real quick. So if now I'm in another different outfit and I look a little frazzled, it's because this is 3 days of me fighting with my computer, fighting with OBS, which I am now considering very seriously finding a different software to work with because I trust me, this is not the first time this has happened to me. Except this time I lost all video and all audio for 3 days. So it is 3 days of me working tirelessly to try to get this out to you. But here it is. Thank you.
trust you. Should you see your maker's face tonight? Look him in the eye, look him in the eye, tell him.
Give me 1 sec, okay? Okay, so I'm just gonna turn this up so you guys can hear me, so I don't have to talk really loud. Okay, so we know at the end of the first part that his last words were basically, it's time to let you go, or I'm ready to let you go, which you guys know my theory of it, and I've heard from several of your comments, even though, wow, I never thought of it that way. But yeah, probably life support was what he was doing. My feeling of the first part was he was basically his way of making those final amends with his mom. His way of saying, him saying goodbye, his last words, whatever he wanted to say to her. Basically saying, look, we've had the riff forever, and who cares at this point? It doesn't matter, Mom. You have your beliefs. You believe whatever you need to believe, and it's okay, whatever, you know. It can go on the back burner. At this point, it doesn't, it's okay, you know. And but then him also having kind of wrestling with this decision, because he's been told he has to make the decision to take her off life support. So he's also dealing with that internally, while he also externally is talking with his mom, having these talks. Even if she's in a coma and can't talk back or whatever it happens to be, it doesn't matter. It's not an easy thing. And so when you say those final words to someone, either it's okay, you can let go now, or it's okay, you know, it's time to say goodbye. Whether they're awake or not, those are generally the words that you say to someone. Just before they turn off the machines. So yeah, so that's my theory on the first one. And I also think that the first one is very much open to interpretation, as Tool's music generally is, and their lyrics generally are. And that's why they're so relatable to so many people, because you can kind of put them into your own personal story and make them a part of you. And that's why they have the following that they have, and that's why they're so personal to a lot of people, because God, he's so brilliant in his, not only in his lyrics, but in his musicality, because certain groups can do this, and Tool is one of them, where the instrumental, the music, is just as much part of the lyric as the lyrics are. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? They emote just as much emotion as the lyrics do. They're just as intricate a part of the whole thing. So I think he ends off with that in the first song, and then here in the second song, I had to write myself some notes because there were so many things going on. I had to remember what was going on, because you know me, I experience music emotionally and logically. Both sides of my brain are going, and if I don't write it down, I don't remember. I can't even read my writing here. So in a way, it was kind of a blessing and a curse, because there were some things that I wanted to say about the song, and you saw that I had scribbled them quickly in notes that I couldn't read afterwards because it was all chicken scratch, but I had also left a couple of things out. The one thing, when the song had first begun, that had really kind of, like, got to me was, you can almost hear them doing, like, a death march in the beginning, and this thunder and lightning storm that's going on, like this crashing thunder and everything. Everyone from the Greeks to the Romans to the Norse, all of them believed actually their most powerful deity was the controller of lightning and thunder. I mean, think about it. You've got Odin, you've got Zeus, and you've got Thor. All of them, right? Thunder and lightning. The god of thunder and lightning. They were also their most powerful and highest god, right? So, anyway, I think it's very interesting also that when he talks about God in this, he refers back into mythology in a way. He talks about Zion, he talks about the river, stuff like that. So he's talking about things in a mythological way, not necessarily in a theological way. So there's like a play on the words in the beginning. It's kind of, first it's like listen to how people romanticize, then it turns around and goes, romanticize is replaced by, is it recognize or whatever? But basically, I think he's talking about heaven there, where he's like, people romanticize heaven, you know, oh, your final resting place in heaven is just such a beautiful place. And then it basically, he turns it around to what people realize, I think is the word that he uses. But basically, he turns it around to, oh, but this is what it actually is when you die. So I think that's where he's kind of coming from. He says, how we rise to the height of our halo when we die. And of course, he's talking about heaven there, right? Again, he makes this reference to heaven, how we rise to our halo. You can tell that there's a huge divide between their faiths still, even in her death. But he's handling it in a more respectful way, where when he's talking about these things and talking to her about these things, he's talking about it in his type of religious way, whether it be he's an atheist, a pagan, an agnostic, whatever it is that he is, it's definitely not Christian, whereas his mother definitely is extremely Christian, whether it be Catholic, Protestant, whatever. Their belief systems are not the same whatsoever. However, he's let it go. He even said that in the last song, where he's like, it's not a problem anymore, Mom. I'm not going to allow this to get between us. You know what I'm saying? That's what I find interesting about the thunder and lightning. Because it means that the gods are angry. They're angry. They're not happy about what's going on right now, you know? And all of this is going on as he's talking about these Judases, these siblings, you know, spewing sympathies, spare me, you know, like I told you before, it was in a very kind of like, just spare me. You didn't give a fuck when she was alive or whatever. Or if it happens to be other siblings, meaning her cohorts, her fellow Christians, you know, just spewing out, you know, sympathies or platitudes, just spare me. You know, I don't believe in that shit anyway. They're probably saying stuff like, oh, don't worry, one day you'll be back with her in heaven and stuff like that. And he's probably like, just, you know what, spare me. So it could have many different connotations. It could be siblings of his that didn't really care, you know, didn't have the attention to his mother or take care of her as well when she was, you know, sick for that many years and he was there for her. Or it could be siblings as in her cohorts in the Christian church, just saying things to him like, don't worry, you'll see her again, you know, blah, 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 heaven, this or that. And he's just like, God, spare me. Just fuck off, you know? So it could be that type of thing too, you know, it could have that double meaning. He has had in this series of songs definitely double meanings to things that he's talked about. The other thing that he does, which I find very interesting, in the song is even though she's dead, he makes like jabs at her religion that I thought, you know, Christians would think were blasphemous in a way. One of them is where he talks about her standing at the gates, where normal, you know, Christians would be like, if she was a really good person, obviously she would go to heaven. St. Peter would be at the gate. He would open the gate wide for her. She would just walk right in. And there would be no question or whatever. But he talks about her standing at the gates of heaven, demanding, give me what I deserve. I want this. I want that. I deserve this from the Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. And it's like, okay. I find that all slightly humorous, and I'm sorry, I'm not picking on Christians. I'm really not, because you guys know I'm not Christian. However, I was for a majority of my life. I had it pounded into me. So you guys know I know my Bible. I know everything about it. But what I find humorous about it is, number one, it shows how deep she was, how faithful she was for her to say the Father, Son, and the Holy Ghost, because only about a third of Christians out there believe in the Holy Ghost, right? That's definitely like a Lutheran thing, definitely a Catholic thing, where most people just think in God and Jesus. They don't believe in the Holy Spirit. But for her to sit there and demand at the holy gates, let me in. I want this. I want that. I deserve. Give me what I deserve. This is my time. My time. I deserve this. Okay. How blasphemous is that? That's just like out of this world crazy, right? The other thing is when he uses the term, he refers to her as the light and the way. The only other time in the Bible where anyone ever is described as the light and the way is Jesus. Jesus describes himself when he is going around, you know, doing his, you know, prophet thing, you know, he's going around on the mountaintops and he's spreading the word and stuff like that. What he says to the people is, I am the light and the way. There's a little bit more to it, you know, but he uses that exact same terminology. I am the light and the way. He's the only person ever to use that. And Christians know him by that. They say that about him. Jesus was the light and the way. So for him to say that about his mother, number one, continues to put her on the pedestal that she was always on. And number two, it's like a little blasphemous. And some Christians are going to take offense to that, right? Well, no, she can't be the light in the way. The only light in the way was Jesus. Now, here's the third and final one that I found interesting is, in the end, he says, very quietly, he says, when you meet your maker in the end, right? I'm paraphrasing, but when you meet your maker in the end, look him in the eye and say, I never told a lie. I never took a life, but I saved a life. Now, to some people that might seem innocuous, it's not that big a deal, blah, 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 blah. But no one in the Christian religion would say, how dare you say you would grab a hold of your maker, Jesus or God, in this case he's talking about God, and say, give me my wings, I deserve, because this is what he's basically saying, give me my wings, I deserve to be an angel, I never told a lie, I never took a life, but I saved one. So he's saying it in the way of, she saved my life. Because the other thing he said was, she was my supporter. She was my eyes. And she was, I forget the last thing he said, but he said, she was my support, she was my eyes, and basically she was my unconditional love. And I think that can also be taken two ways, because I think he's saying that about his mom, but I think his mom said that about God. And so that's also a double entendre right there. But again, it puts his mom back up on that pedestal where he's saying, say this to your maker, because you deserve your wings, so you say this. But Christians would say, how dare you demand of God anything? God will do what he pleases, you know? Those were the things that I caught. The rest of the commentary will be on the other video. Where the other thing that I find very interesting about anyone who's ever been to any type of church, Christian church ever, knows that song. As from a child, you learn this song. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. You guys know that song, right? He puts those lyrics in there, but he puts a spin on them. And he says, this little light of mine. And then he adds, that you gave to me. Then he says, I'm gonna let it shine to guide it safely on your way home. And I was just like, when I heard it, I was like, how brilliant is that? Yeah, you guys got to look at this chicken scratch, because I'm trying to listen to the music and write down all these little notes. So half of them like up in here, I can't even read those. So I can't even tell you what that was about. But I'm trying to like, I'm like listening and vibing to the music and trying to like, so if you guys saw me for a minute there, I looked like I was spaced out and I wasn't into the music. It wasn't that. I was trying to write these little notes so I wouldn't forget them. And now I can't even read them all. Whew. Nope. I said I wasn't going to lose it on this one, and I'm keeping it all together. You can tell it's all right in here. My face is all red. I'm talking a little strained and my heart's beating a little fast. And that's because I'm trying to get off this video as soon as possible so that way I can cry. I was too focused on my notes. The music in this video, in this song, is just exemplary. It is amazing. It's just the beat drives it when it needs to, yet it's very subtle and soft and beautiful when it needs to be that. They outdid themselves, and I'm so glad I didn't do both these in one sitting, or else I would have been just, I would have had a nervous breakdown. Thank you guys for suggesting this set of four songs. They were beautiful, they were gorgeous, and they were so worth telling this story. This story needs to be told over and over and over again. It is a piece of art. So, yeah. I hope all of you guys are staying safe and healthy, and please ensure that you guys do everything you can to remain that way. Have a wonderful day, guys, and please remember to comment, like, and subscribe. Please hit that notification bell so you know when I drop my next video. And what else? Yeah, it's all about love in 2020 and beyond, guys. And as always, take care of each other, because no one else is going to. Ciao.